Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah wahdah wassalatu wassalamu ala man la nabiyya ba'da. Innal hamdalillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa nu'minu wa tawakkalu alayhi wa na'udzu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina may yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa may yudlilhu fala hadiya lahu. Amma ba'd. We are 1 week into 1442 AH after Hijrah. And I think it's a good time to reflect on some of the lessons of the Hijrah that can be applied to our context as South African Muslims. Usually, this Friday, a couple days before Ashurah, the khutbah will focus on Karbala or the fast or the virtue of Ashurah. In the second khutbah, we'll go a little bit into the virtue of Ashurah, but for the first khutbah, I want to focus instead on the Hijrah. Because very often in our focus on Ashura, we forget about what the calendar is based on. Our calendar is not based on the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or on the day that he became a prophet, or on the day that he conquered Makkah. It's based on the day that, or on the year that he moved to Medina, on the year of the Hijrah. Why? Because the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a turning point in Islamic history. And I just want to give a few parallels today of how the early Muslims did Hijrah right and how we did it wrong, and the results of the two. So in the early years of Islam, the most famous Hijrah we know is of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Makkah to Medina. But this was not the only migration that was done in that time. Before that, there was the two hijras to Abyssinia. After the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the time of the Sahaba, many Sahaba moved to Yemen, to Iraq, to Syria, to Egypt, and to other lands as well. What all of these hijras have in common is that when Muslims move into a land, they transformed it forever. The impact of a Sahabi or a Tabi'i or the Prophet ﷺ moving to a land was such that we still feel it until today. If you look at places like Iraq, which at that point in time was a Zoroastrian land, was part of Persia, if you go there today, you would never say that because we know it to be a Muslim land. Syria, Sham, which at that point in time was Christian land, was a Christian Arab land. Today, we know it as a Muslim land. So, the early Muslims, when they migrated to a land, their presence in that land transformed the place. It had a ripple effect on society. We see this with the Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Medina. Then he and the Sahaba, they moved to Medina, and within a few years, they are ruling all of Arabia. And within a few decades, the Muslims are ruling across three continents. Now compare that to our forefathers' migration. And I don't say this as a slight to our forefathers, but for us to reflect on our position in the society. Because for most of us who are living here and who are part of this community, we fall two types of Muslims, right? Or rather three types. They are amongst us immigrants, those who have come from other countries. They are amongst us native Muslims, people whose forefathers are from this land and who became converted to Islam at some point. And many Muslims in our community are descendants of immigrants, meaning, depending on which part of the country, in the Cape for the past 300 years, but here in our city for the past 100 years, there have been Muslims who migrated here and have been living here. And what I want us to reflect on is, why haven't we had the same impact across 300 to 100 years that the early Muslims did? What went wrong? Why is it that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam could move to Medina and within 10 years the entire place is transformed? That Sahaba could move to Syria and move to Iraq and move to Egypt, and within a decade or two the entire place is transformed. But then Muslims moved to South Africa And within 100 years, we haven't really improved our spiritual or social standing. So I want to point out four things from the Hijrah of the early Muslims that they did differently from us, and that we can still apply, even though we are not technically immigrants, but we can still apply to transform Islam in this society. Number one is intention. The opening hadith of Sahih Bukhari, we very often quote only the first half of the hadith. And many people are unaware that the hadith is actually about Hijrah. Right? The opening hadith of Sahih Bukhari is, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Every action is judged by its intention, and every person will get what they intended. But that's not the full hadith. The hadith goes on. So whoever's Hijrah is for Allah and His Messenger will have the reward of making Hijrah for Allah and His Messenger. And whoever's Hijrah is for marrying a woman or for something of this dunya that they want, then that is what they will have. So what was the intention of people who came to South Africa compared to the Sahaba and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The early Muslims, their intention was for Allah. Whether they moved to Medina or whether they were leaving their beloved Medina to move to Syria or to Iraq or to Yemen, it was all for Allah. It was all for the da'wah. It was all for spreading the religion of Allah to new lands. Our mistake is that we fall into the last category. Whoever's hijrah was for the dunya, that is what they will have. Many Muslims came to South Africa for dunya and Allah gave us dunya. Right? We have dunya in this country, alhamdulillah. But that's not what the life of a Muslim is supposed to be about. Our life is supposed to be about Allah. So we can still rectify our intention. Why are we living in South Africa? Are we living here for dunya or are we living here for Allah? There's some people who will say, oh, but you know, Hijrah is supposed to be towards a majority Muslim land. When the Prophet moved to Medina, it was not a majority Muslim land. When the Sahaba moved to Syria, it was not a majority Muslim land. No place on earth was initially a majority Muslim land. Muslims made Hijrah there, they settled there, they married into there, they became part of the culture, and over time it became a majority Muslim land. So Africa can be the same. But we need to imitate first the intentions and then the methodology of the early Muslims. The second point, and you see this particularly in the success of the migration to Medina, is Dawah. Because even before moving to Medina, the Prophet ﷺ sent Mus'ab ibn Umayr to Medina a few years earlier to do what? Dawah. He went and he lived in Medina years before the Prophet ﷺ. He moved there and he spent time with the people. He got to know the people, got to know their culture. He sat with them in groups, explained to them the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and people began to convert. Families began to convert. And most importantly, he walked up to the chiefs of Aus and Khazraj, and he gave them the da'wah. And when they converted, the entire tribe converted. This is again something that's missing in our Hijrah. Muslims in South Africa have still not embraced the spirit of da'wah. And wherever I go, when I try talking about da'wah, we hear excuses. One excuse people make is to, oh, they can see us. We don't need to do da'wah, they can see us. They can see our masjid, they can hear our azan. They can Google something if they want to. Right? You realize if they Google something, they're going to end up on the Islamophobes websites. They're going to end up on the ex-Muslims websites. What guarantee they're going to the right websites? They can see us, they can't understand us. We need to be out there explaining to them our message. We need to be approaching leaders, doing da'wah to leaders of communities, to entire communities, come with them into Islam. Dawah is something that is missing in South Africa. It's not being done on a scale that it should have been done. Alhamdulillah, we had in this community many decades ago Sheikh Ahmed Didar rahimahullah. But anyone who knows him and his story knows how much the rest of the country opposed Islam. We need people today who are going to take up the message and spread it in our society. So first was intention. Number two was da'wah. Number three is integration within the limits of the Sharia. In our Sharia, we have a principle called al-adab muhakkama. Local culture is the deciding factor. And all four madhabs agree upon this principle. And it is specifically important in the Hanafi madhab. What this principle means is that when Muslims move to a new culture, they must adapt to that culture. They must adapt all of the halal of that culture. They should not bring foreign cultures with them. So when the Prophet ﷺ and his Sahaba moved from Makkah to Medina, they adapted to the culture of Medina to such an extent that many of them could not come back to Makkah because they got so accustomed to the Medina lifestyle. And right till today, anyone who goes for Umrah will know Makkah and Medina have very different cultures. It was even bigger in terms of difference in that time. When the Sahaba moved to Syria, they adapted to the culture so much that when Umar ibn Khattab went to visit Syria and visit the Sahaba, he said that he did not recognize anyone except Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah. He's the only one who remained upon the Medina culture. Everybody else just became like a Syrian. They dressed like them, they lived like them, they built their houses like them. They became part of the culture. When the Sahaba moved to Iraq, same thing. When they moved to Egypt, same thing. And so we have all of these cultural variants of Islam. We have Turkish Islam, we have Malaysian Islam, we have Indian Islam. All of it is fine, as long as it's within the boundaries of Sharia. The problem when we came to South Africa is that instead of coming here and formulating a South African Islam, we tried to import Indian Islam. And that became a barrier, number one, for implementing Islam in this country, and number two, for Dawah. Because instead of doing Dawah to Allah, we're doing Dawah towards Indian culture. So it is our duty, if we want Islam to spread in this land, that we adapt to South Africa in every way that is halal. And we don't try to import foreign cultures upon the people of South Africa. My fourth and final point about the migration, what they did right and what we did wrong. And that is community building. One of the very first things that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did when he moved to Medina was to build bonds of brotherhood between the locals and the immigrants, the Muhajir and the Ansar. He created a sense of brotherhood between them, that they literally thought of each other as family. They had this close tie with people they never met before in their lives. Our forefathers come to South Africa during a time of apartheid. And sadly, even though apartheid ended 20 years ago, it hasn't really left the hearts of people. Our community is still divided on race, on tribe, on economic levels, and as long as these divisions remain, we will not be able to grow at the rate that Islam can grow. I have visited other lands. I have seen the way Islam is spreading in the USA. I've seen the way Islam is spreading in the United Kingdom. I've seen the way Islam is spreading across many other countries. Islam came to South Africa long before those countries, but they've overtaken us in numbers. Why? Because we're not doing something right. So these are four things we can change to hopefully turn this around. Number one, what is our intention for living here? Because yes, in Islam, you even need an intention for where you are living. Are you living for dunya or are you living for Allah? Number two, da'wah, in any form that we can, whether it's practicing Islam, whether it's being a role model of Islamic character, whether it's having some pamphlets or brochures in our shops, whether it's sharing some beneficial videos, whatever it is. But da'wah should be something we all are involved in to some level. Number three, becoming part of the culture instead of trying to import foreign cultures. And number four, building ties of community across all boundaries. Economic boundaries, racial boundaries, tribal boundaries, building ties across all of them. If we can do this, and there's much more that we can talk about, much more that we need to do, but this is a start. If we can do this, and inshallah, we break some of these barriers, and Islam can spread rapidly in this land as it does in other lands. سبحان ربي الأعلى سيكون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين ونستغفره ونؤمن ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد. We are in the month of Muharram, and I just want to share very very briefly with you two of the virtues of Muharram. Number one, fasting the 10th of Muharram. This is a fast that the Prophet ﷺ emphasized, and he loved this fast the most of all of the optional fasts. And the reward for this fast, the Prophet ﷺ stated, whoever fasts the 10th of Muharram, all of his previous years minor sins are forgiven. Which of us don't need that? Every single Muslim has their sins, and we need every year these methods to wipe away our sins. Part of Allah's infinite rahmah is that every few days or months there's something coming up to wipe away our sins. This month is the fast of the 10th of Muharram. So let us fast the 10th of Muharram so that our sins can be purified. A second lesser known virtue of the 10th of Muharram, and this is also because it is debated and there is difference of opinion on the authenticity of this hadith, is the virtue of spending on your family on the 10th of Muharram. There is a hadith in which it is narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said that whoever spends on their family on the 10th of Muharram, Allah will put barakah in their wealth for the rest of the year. Now there are two or three opinions regarding the authenticity of this hadith. Some ulama have declared it weak, some have declared it acceptable, and some have declared it authentic. I am of the opinion that it's authentic because many of my teachers and many of the early Muslims, they tried the hadith. What do you mean by they tried the hadith? So they see the scholars think, is this authentic, not authentic? Okay, let's try it out. So they spent on their family the 10th of Muharram, and they had barakah that year. And they did the next year, and they had barakah that year. And this is something, you know, one of the salaf said he spent 50 or 60 years practicing this hadith, and every year he had barakah. So based on the experience of these ulama, we can say there is something to this. And this hadith is most likely authentic. So on the 10th of Muharram this year, let's do two things. Number one, let's fast for the sake of Allah to purify our past year sins. Number two, let us spend on our families. Maybe take them out or buy for them takeaways from an expensive restaurant or buy them desserts, whatever it is. Spend on your families on the 10th of Muharram so there's barakah in our wealth for the next year. Look at the two blessings, the previous year and the next year.